Hey, welcome back to session 19 of 120B, 220B. Today will be actually one of our last class sessions where you hear me yakking a lot. We'll go through, and on Thursday, go ahead and turn the floor over to you to go through and share all your good project work. And the nature of that will hopefully be, it's kind of a very freewheeling sharing session where you talk about some of the interesting things going on in your projects, both some of the successes and the challenges, and we sort of kibitz along. But don't think about it as a formal presentation. Okay, so if it helps you, I would recommend going ahead to think about specifically what you are going to talk about, you know, a couple of specific features, but plan that out in advance so we're not just kind of wandering generally. But also at the same time, don't feel obligated to go through and create a very complete PowerPoint set that kind of walks through the entire project. Okay, it's really more about kind of like interactive discussion about what's going on. In terms of, just thinking about where we are on the whole design project and just sort of finishing up in the class, the idea is at some level you've been maintaining a series of different check-ins where you're meeting with Alana or Angad or myself, and just kind of journaling about that. And several people have been very good about journaling, putting a lot of stuff out there. Other people, you know, have skipped some steps along the way in terms of the different check-ins. But to be really complete, you know, you're sort of looking at these sorts of check-ins. You know, everything from the preliminary design ones to the structural system and the analysis. Finally, for the last couple weeks worth of work, the big thing is really have something that talks about your HVAC system, your heating and cooling system, your plumbing system, to some of those different things, and ultimately you're going to put together a final check-in. Now, if you haven't been checking in diligently week after week, don't feel like you have to go back and sort of make up a whole lot of missing check-ins, okay? It is nice to go through and put it all in this very structured way, so if you can organize your analysis or organize the way you present it into these sort of buckets, it's very easy for us to follow them in terms of saying, oh, we want to look specifically at your structural system or something like that. But yeah, at this point, I think the bigger task at hand is really just putting together a final check-in, which will really summarize a lot of these different things. In terms of the final presentations, the part that you're going to be sharing with us on Thursday, think about having about 15 minutes to do this. And really focus on what I'll call 2 to 3 highlights of your project. Now you have to orient us all to your project a little bit because, well, the TAs and I, we know sort of what's going on in your project and you do. Not everyone is as familiar with what you have or working on, although we've talked about it a lot through the class, so people have a general idea about, you know, where it's located, what the purpose is, a little bit about the architectural features, things like that. But your focus is primarily going to be on it's things that are sort of either the building systems themselves or design features that are affecting the building systems. So things like, oh, your building envelope and how it's affecting the daylighting or how it's affecting some sort of aspect about heating and cooling so that you're trying to like do sensitive architectural design to sort of maximize the performance of those systems. Okay, think about sharing what I'll call your inspired ideas or your insights. Think also where the challenges have been. So things that are particularly interesting to me are places where you headed off in one direction and thought something would be a good direction, but then somewhere along the way figured out, oops, maybe that's not going to work, and you had to pivot a little bit. Okay, those are always kind of interesting learning places because we all enjoy our successes. We want to talk about our successes, but we also want to sort of say, you know, honestly share with each other about, like, you know, where some of those challenges are, because probably everyone to some extent has faced a lot of those different challenges, and people have decided how to go through and address them. You know, sometimes when we run into a challenge, you decide to kind of rethink your entire strategy. Other times we say, nope, you know, hey, I'm committed to an error strategy. I've gone this way. I realize now it might have not been the best strategy, but I'm going to finish it out, and that's okay. You know, then I'd say that you have some successes, you have some challenges, you even have some next steps, and that would be where I'd say, if you have rethought something, and if you had to do it all over again with the benefit of what you know today, you know, how you would advise someone else who is taking on this project to think about it. So, I should have just put in another hair handler on the other side of the building. You know, there's those aha insights that kind of come at some point. It's like, oh, this was so great, but the structure got so complicated. I think maybe I'd tell people to simplify. You know, whatever it is, we all have you know, those different lessons. So go ahead and kind of think about what your lessons are too, you know, for yourself. Okay, after you make your final project presentation this coming Thursday, your very final step will be to check it on in. And what you'll do with your project is, theoretically, by Sunday at midnight, you'll get that checked in your final one. If you need to extend a little into finals week, that's okay. I'm gonna caution you about doing that though, just in that it's sort of good just to have this one done with and have a clear finals week so you can focus on all your exams and everything else that is necessary, you know, that you have to get done next week. So if you can get it all turned on Friday, on Sunday, that is super. As with all projects, 80% it'll be what you're very happy about, and 20% there'll be loose ends flying all over the place that you, if you had more time, you would fix up, and that's okay. It's just sort of understood that, you know, no one's project's gonna be 100% complete, stuff like that. There's always room for improvement. Every project I ever do, there's always more that I'd like to have done to it, but at some point you just gotta turn it in and, you know, time takes over. Okay, so in terms of the final check-in, again, for that final check-in, sort of summarize what you talked about in your project presentation, your successes, your challenges, your next steps. And then for your final check-in, if you could please post all of your models, and you have several now, you should have an architectural model, a structural model, a mechanical model. You know, your mechanical model may be several pieces. You might have HVAC versus plumbing, or you could have it in the same model. Either way is just fine. So put all those different models out on the A360 site in your folder there, so we can grab them all and take a look at them. And even better, if you can go through and integrate them together in BIM 360 glue, okay, we can actually see how all those pieces work together. And that's one of those things we want to ultimately try to understand and have you understand is really, at some level, you know, are there conflicts? Does it all work together? We've all been doing our best planning. Hey, no worries, come on, have a seat. Hold on. You're always welcome. No worries. So, think about just how they all kind of link together. And even if you're not going to resolve all those clashes or the different inconsistencies, at least put it in there and understand where they are. So it would be on your list of next steps. So that you can say, my ductwork's hitting the structure. I either need to come up with a smaller structure, a more compact ductwork structure, or maybe think about increasing the floor-to-floor height. Yeah, it's such, there's some realization that'll come out of that. Okay, so let's pause right here and just sort of see how people feel or understand the final deliverables and how you're going to finish up. Do you have a good sense? If you thought about what you're doing between now and Sunday on this project, do you have a pretty good sense of what you're up to? Okay. He's getting sort of. You got a sense of how to, how about you, Britt? You sort of have a sense of how you're going to wrap it up?
Good. I think so. I've just been working on the presentation.
No worries. You're all busy with so many different things. At some point, you know, with all this, you know, I'm all about it. It's the learning journey you've been on. We sort of get to the point. You know, you got a lot of stuff going on this week. So, yeah, I just want you to be fair to yourself in terms of not just spending hours and hours and hours trying to perfect the model at the end. Yeah, because the fact that, you know, some things didn't work is, it's a valuable learning. That's okay. Okay, then in terms of, so Thursday, the idea is come on in and be ready to talk about your project. Okay, if you aren't going to be able to be here on Thursday, and this is a comment for everyone who's like listening remotely or maybe missing today or won't be able to attend on Thursday, what you will be doing is actually recording your presentation. So you'll go through and make a presentation on your own computer. You can do it on a computer in here, whatever you want. We can set you up with the software for doing that. But you're basically gonna record to the camera or something like that and share it with us that way. So that ultimately we can put them all out there on YouTube and share them all. Okay, so if anyone is listening and they're wondering about how to do that, the tool that I use an awful lot is something called Ink2Go that's available both in a Mac and a PC version. What happens is if you click on the little camera icon, you get the camera, we can actually see you, kind of moving and talking and stuff like that. But within here, there's also the ability to record the video. So, where'd it go? Screen capture, start a movie right there. we could go through and just record a movie of you talking, and you can move the mouse around, draw with a funny little color markers, whatever it is that you need to do to kind of capture it. But it's a pretty easy way of just capturing a movie of what you're doing as a little narrated screen kind of walkthrough. So that's Ink2Go, a good tool if you can't be here. Okay, so let us see if we can make some sense of this. Ah, final things here. Class evaluations are out there. So if you can, please go ahead and fill out the course evaluation online. Last quarter at this time, they didn't quite work. So go ahead and get on out there and see if they are working. They should be there available for access. As you go through and fill them out, please, 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 the thing that's most helpful to us is just your suggestions and comments about how to improve the course, how to make it better, you know, how you'd change things up if you were thinking about teaching this, you know, as advice to the teaching team so we can think about, you know, making it better the next time around. Okay, so, and we actually do take those comments very much to heart. You know, the course is continually changed. If you follow some of the old videos from year to year and quarter to quarter, it actually keeps on evolving quite a bit based upon people's suggestions from past quarters. So please think about, you know, not only your experience, but the experience of future generations and, you know, how if you were trying to help them understand and convey the same sort of information, the same sort of appreciations, you know, what would help it be a little bit clearer, more understandable, things like that. Okay. So we really do appreciate it when you take the time to fill that out. Okay. In terms of specific systems, just things we're finishing up with today, plumbing systems, we pretty much covered most everything I wanted to talk about last time in terms of thinking about both the kind of restroom situation with a hot and cold kind of domestic water, as well as possibly using gray water as a substitution for the sanitary. We also talked a little about fire sprinkler systems. That's actually sort of, again, a fairly easy system to go through and model. Because, you know, once you locate the different sprinklers in the ceilings at different locations, routing them together tends to be a fairly automatic thing. It's much more forgiving than the other sorts of fixtures because they're very far spaced, they're spaced out pretty far apart, and the network automatically tends to figure out a pretty good layout for how to run the pipes. The biggest concern you typically have with fire sprinkler systems is just the height you specify for them, because you have to think about the level at which they're running versus your other pipes, versus your ductwork and your structure. Although, what'll often happen is, since fire sprinkler pipes are relatively small relative to structure, they often run up within the structural layer. If you have beams that have open web joists, or you even have beams where sometimes we cut out in the beams and we have different penetrations through the beam flanges, or beam web. You can like go through and like have those penetrations. They're relatively small. As opposed to ductwork, ductwork's so big that it's, you try to cut out an opening in a beam web to do something like that, it's really, really hard to go through and kind of do it without greatly compromising the beam. If you're thinking about having your fire sprinkler piping intersect with the beams, always be thinking about, actually I should ask you guys, some of you guys are structurally, if you had the choice of where in the total height of the beam, let's go ahead and say, this is my big old beam. Okay, and I needed to run a fire sprinkler through that, some piece of piping through that. You know, where would be the best place to do it? Should I put it at the top? Should I put it at the bottom? Should I put it in the middle? Where actually makes the most sense? Any guesses?
Below it.
What's that? Below it's actually the best.
Possible.
Okay, so down there would be the best. Okay, but if we actually had to go through and violate the beam, where's a good place to put it? What's that?
The middle.
Ah, very good. And why is the middle such a good spot? Exactly. You're thinking exactly right. When we go through and we kind of put a cutout right through the center of the beam, that's typically the neutral axis. So although it does compromise in terms of shear, it's taking away a little bit of area right there. Yeah, it's not putting it at the extreme tension or the extreme compression. So it's actually considered to be the best place to go through and put it. So if you're looking at whether it's steel beams or even wooden beams, there's all these engineered wood beams and you need to sometimes cut piping through them. They do this an awful lot in residential construction. We plan out the structure carefully.
Like a lot of them that are rolled with those hose within it?
Yes.
Yeah,
I know. The ones that actually have the holes in them, even better, because that's providing a vehicle so you can very easily run things through. These are mostly solid. If you ever see the type of joists that look like this are really sort of very good. The ones where they have a top flange, they have a bottom flange, and then like trusses or open web joists like this. This is more looking at it in an elevation view. Those are really, really good. Your plumbers will love you for these because they can run pipes all the way through there. Even sometimes for your mechanical, depending on the size of this, if you, for example, have a round duct that's 12 inches, you might even be able to slip those in there too. Okay. But in general, trusses tend to be very nice in that they don't always span open spans, but they give you the ability to go through and run things through them. Where we get in trouble is when you have these big old solid beams, like a big old concrete beam. We could put a shaft or a little sleeve through that. What happens, I was going to say, in residential construction, you know, a lot of times I'll put in big old engineered beams, the big solid paralams and things like that. The plumber decides really the best place to run the sanitary line is right through that. Okay, so they go cutting some giant 5-inch hole in the middle of your beam because they want to go through and run that sanitary line through it. And that is really just kind of devastating. So if I go through and I have a big old beam, in this case it could be a big old wooden beam, and I go cutting some big old hole that looks like this right through the middle of it, what happens is I've essentially just invalidated the beam. There's really very, very little going on in terms of support for the tension and stuff like that. So that's a real concern you have to watch out for. Inspectors get very upset when people start cutting things through because, you know, sometimes as an engineer you have to go back and reconfirm the calculations that say the beam will still be okay even with that big penetration going through it. So the big thing is just trying to think about those conflicts and where they go. Okay, so rolling way back, where you're putting all the fixtures, if you can, go ahead and run it around, super. Hot and cold water you can, even sprinklers you can run under and around things because they're high pressure, so the water will still be pressurized around it. But the only thing you can't do it with is, again, sanitary, either sanitary or gray water collection, anything where you're depending on gravity to feed it. Okay, but all the other systems are kind of A-okay. So super. Go through and run those, and then at the end of it all, what you really want to do is try to do your little model integration step. So model integration, what that's all about, that's really saying, take your different models that you've been creating independently, your architectural, your structural, your mechanical, and send them all up to BIM 360 Glue. Glue them on up there, okay, so that we can go through and take a look. And we looked at this briefly a couple weeks ago, okay, in terms of, let me go back over to Revit. Oh, how about this? I'll go into Revit. We can open up one of the ones that we have hanging around here. For example, I'll just bring up the Audubon Center, which I've brought up in the past. I'll say, let's take a look at the Revit files. So great, I have that architectural model. You'll have your architectural model. We'll do the same thing. What we're gonna do is just upload that. Okay, so I should get rid of that message. Here's my architectural model. When I want to upload that to Glue, what I'll do is go to add-ins and say Glue. Now again, Glue should be installed because it's installed automatically when Revit installs. If Glue complains at all when you try to upload things, it's typically because the extension or the add-in's a little out of date relative to the server, so it could complain. The way to combat that is to go to the Autodesk Application Manager. Ooh, looks like I have something new. Let's see what I have in there. Open. Got a new version of Navisworks Manage. I got a new version for Autodesk Revit, release 2, and some new versions of computational fluid dynamics. So what I should do, and I won't do it right now, is go through and choose these and update them all. That'll bring this all up to date. What you're looking for, if you're having any troubles, is there anything that says BIM 360 glue add-in for Revit? And if that hasn't been updated, you want to go through and update that to its latest version. Let's see what the last one was that I have in here. Even older than that. Okay. What'll tend to happen is on your own personal machines, this is fairly easy to keep up to date. On these cluster machines, it's much harder because you're never quite sure where you're sitting and who's run the update last and all that stuff. But go through and update these things. Okay, if you are updating them, you should be able to say glue the model. Again, choosing a 3D model. Choose your host. Then choose your project. You should all have projects. Oh, for example, what do I have here? Let's go ahead and who can we pick on? Just because they're not here right now. You can pick on Christine, just because she's not here right now. Okay, say okay to that. We'll choose which file we want to do. I'm just going to do the 3D view. Okay, you can upload many of the different files or views, but you really only need to get one of them. And the one by default I'm going to get is the 3D. Say next. I'm going to give it a name, though, so I can spot it. Architectural. Say glue that out. Okay, it'll export it. And if you're going to get an error message, this is the place it'll typically happen. It's on this export step. It'll say something about, hey, I can't communicate with the server. See what's happening in the background there. It looks like it's still working. Uploading the architectural model, that looks pretty good. Model being glued, okay. That is success. We know that's gonna work. You'll do something similarly to the mechanical and the structural. And when you get all done, what we do is go into BIM 360 Glue. I'll open it here. Again, if you don't have it on your desktop, there's the ever popular b4.autodesk.com/desktop, which uploads downloads the Glue application to your machine. See, I'm still running GBX in our Green Building Studio in the background from this morning's class. Okay, sign in over here. Okay, once you get over here, running clash detection is really very simple. I'm gonna go to BSI Glue. Okay, there's some new announcements here, so already linked files and construction parts. I'm just gonna close that for now. And say that we want to take a look. Now, I put that out in Christine's file, but let me actually find, there's a one that says demo project, and I could probably just go for that one. Where's Christine's right there? I'll just grab that. There's sample project. If you open sample project, I think that's one that you all have access to too, I believe. If you don't, go through and just open it up, or if you do, just open it up. What I'll do is I'll create a new merge model. What I'd love to do is basically get the structural, the mechanical, and the architectural all together. So I can say new merge model, go ahead and grab the architectural, the structural, and the mechanical. All models merged. Oops, that's the filter. And it's going to bring them all together so we can actually do clash detection as well as just walk through. If you haven't walked through your building yet with all the different systems, it's kind of an interesting thing to do. nice thing about BIM 360 Glue is you can walk through even in this environment. You can walk through in the Chrome browser. So if you want to share your model with someone who doesn't have BIM 360, you can go through and just give them the link and they can open it in the Chrome browser. You can also do it on an iPad. So it's a lot of ways for navigating through this thing. Okay, you're sort of seeing the model all together now. I see the architecture, I see the structure coming in there right now. I think the mechanicals in there too. Let's just take a look and see if we can. And what I'm gonna do is do some walking in. And I actually find it easier to walk on an iPad. Like the interface is a little more straightforward there. I'm up a little high right now, so I'm going to pan down. Still up a little high. So now I can actually start looking around and seeing how the building works. I can just walk through the building, which is kind of a nice thing to do. At any point, I can look up by going to a little, looking like an eyeball, and say, let's look up at the skylight, let's look at the structure, let's look at these ductwork pieces that are running through. Actually, right in front of my very eyes, I already see a problem. I'm not sure if you can spot it there. I have this nice piece of ductwork that's coming through. It's got a tap on the side. And right about there, you see it's actually intersecting one of the beams. Okay, so that's probably going to be an issue for us at some time soon. In fact, I can see a couple different problems. You go through and add a mark up here. I think I actually see a problem right here, and it looks like I'm actually seeing a problem right there too. So I can go through and just go through and visually find all these things and save these away. That's kind of okay. At which point I can say that looks super. I'm going to go through and just save this away. At which point that markup's available so I can come on back to it later. So here I am there, but I'm going to go back to this. Okay. But if you want to be a little more systematic about it, you can actually run clash detection, and clash detection will help you find all those things. And how you do that, again, it's really straightforward. What you do is you go to this tool, which looks like two intersecting boxes. Oops, not markups. And you say you want to find clashes. Now, you always get this choice of basically what it is you're going to be comparing against each other, and it's really, there's sort of a left side to right side list. At some point, you can compare everything all together. But if, for example, you want to start with just saying, let me show the structural versus the mechanical, that'll come up with a certain number of clashes. Sometimes what we'll do, though, is we'll actually subset that a little bit so we're not looking at everything. So for example, in the mechanical, there's mechanical fittings, there's mechanical ducts, there's air terminals, there's all these different things. And if you want to approach this in sort of a hierarchical system way, yeah, I can go through and choose, oh, not everything. So not the electrical, not the conduits, not all those things. I could just say that, you know, really for this first clash, just to sort of understand at a high level how things are working, what would it be if I just went through and clashed the ducts with the structure? Maybe even the duct fittings with the structures. Okay, that'll give me a high level just to get going, because if I have too many clashes, it almost gets overwhelming. You know, you have to kind of think about it in an order. Okay, so I'll say structure versus ducts and fittings. So super. We have a bunch of different things in here. I have 97 things which are considered to be open clashes right now. They're all listed over on the left-hand side, and they have a magnitude that tells you the degree to which they overlap with each other. So if I want to start with and say, what is that 6-inch overlap? Looks like there's pretty squarely something where there's a piece of round duck in green, kind of intersecting with a red wide flange beam. So that looks pretty serious in terms of doing that. I could now say that, hey, that's something I want to notify someone about. So I can say, let's choose that. And let me choose notify. Okay, so I'm going to send this over to my good friend. Oops, that's the message. That's not right. Oh, it's interesting. You guys aren't members of this project. Well, I can't send it to you. Andrew, Pratt, Rami. No, I was going to send it to one of you guys. This is still last year's guys, or last quarter's guys. Okay, no worries. Oh, what can I do? I'll send it to Angad. Hi, Angad. Here's a clash from BIM360. You could ignore this. Otherwise, he's going to try and solve that. Okay, so he's got that message floating around right now. We could go through and organize this a little bit. If you want to, for example, not just have them all just kind of scattered, a good way to think about it is if you'd like to see all the conflicts with certain structural members, you can group it by structural members, and then all the conflicts with each individual structural member will come together. So if you do that, what you'll do is you'll say, let's group it by the structural model. Okay, then you'll see there's actually six different clashes with one specific piece of the structure here, which might make it a little bit easier for going through and doing the solution. Okay, there's six different clashes that are associated with another one. Yeah, chances are all these ones, which are these bar joists in here, you know, these are probably all somehow related to each other. So it might make sense to go through and send those all to a single person. Okay, how it'll work in terms of actually seeing these and fixing these is back over in Revit, if you're in a file, okay, and you go to add-ins, see where I am right now. Looks like I'm in the middle of doing something. Ah, that dialog is still open. Okay. On this side, if you say clash pinpoint, what happens is it'll go out and it'll say that, hey, we'll go out to the project and kind of see, are there any clashes that have been assigned to this project? In this case, there aren't, because I haven't sent them from this project. Okay, but if I do have some, all the clashes that have been assigned to me will be listed here, so you can choose them here, and then it'll go in Revit and navigate to that part where you can actually change the piece that you're responsible for fixing. So that's what clash pinpoint's all about. Okay, so for the most part, that's what clash detection looks like, and as you're going through and doing it, you know, if you can go through and get everything out there and at least find where the clashes are, we can sort of see where a lot of these different clashes are right now, super. You know, you don't feel responsible for going through and fixing everything, because that could actually be an awful lot of work. But, you know, since you do have infinite time available for the rest of this week and like nothing else that is asking for any of your attention, you know, Alana would like you to go through and fix them all. Not really. But, yeah, go ahead and know that you can, something like that. But don't feel obligated to fix them all. But if you, maybe out of this clash analysis, you know, a next step or a lesson learned will come out of it that you can say, I see some of those different pipes and stuff like that. You know, I have to think about maybe segmenting things a little bit more or further apart so that they aren't going to have that clashes, aren't going to have those kinds of types of clashes. Okay. Well, let's stop there on just kind of the clash detection, but is that sort of making sense in terms of doing the model integration? What we'd love to have you do is just go through, get it all up to blue, kind of get it all there so that we can see them all as an integrated model, okay? And you can even go through and find the clashes, but don't feel obligated to fix them all. Okay, super. Okay, let me, before I go into the next part, for the last system we want to talk about today, I want to talk just ever so briefly about electrical systems. Because in a lot of ways, they work very much like all the other systems. You're going to have different terminals, where your terminals may be switches, they may be outlets, they may be lighting fixtures. We somehow link them all together, and as opposed to ductwork or piping, we're going to link them together with wires. Okay, and they're understood as being part of a system, so that as we add up all the different terminals, that system then has a certain load on it, and when we take it back to a panel, an electrical panel, it's gonna need to supply a certain power to kind of power all those devices. So in principle, entirely parallel, stuff like that. But as we get going, are there any questions in general, or just principles about either the HVAC or the plumbing that you wanna talk about? Or should I just dive into this? Or any sort of nagging HVAC questions you're thinking about? How about plumbing questions? I've seen a lot of bathrooms this last week. It sounds awful. And the plumbing between all the different fixtures, and some really good work in terms of putting them all together. Several people are using innovative, all sorts of really cool fixtures, and we're copy monitoring them into the mechanical model to link them all together. But in general, how's that been going in terms of hooking them together? Has that sort of worked okay, or, how would you rate doing plumbing versus doing HVAC in terms of complexity? Which do you think is easier? Any sense? Senchai, what do you think? I tend to agree. There is a little bit of sizing, but the size differences aren't so big that they really start to conflict. Yeah. As you run up bigger and bigger flows, the pipe needs to get a little bit bigger. But it usually goes from inch to inch and a half or 2 inches. It's not like with a ductwork where it went from 12 inches to 24 inches, which became much more of a problem. And it's interesting as you think about the problem with HVAC part of it's that the pipes get bigger, but a lot of the problem just is that when you get to all the bends and connections, that if the pipes got too big, it can't make that bend or connection anymore. So a lot of the problem comes from just all the fittings and whether the new improved sizes, the fittings still apply to them. So I think plumbing's easier, but I'm just curious, Britt, have you gone through and done your plumbing yet? Hey, it's coming. How much for you, Gustavo? Not yet. Okay, Miss Jacqueline, I know you've done some plumbing. So, how would you contrast those two? You have to have incredibly thorough restrooms. You should show your restrooms.
I actually think that they're really similar, the HVAC and the plumbing systems, because I don't know why, but for me, they're not working too automatically for me.
So okay. It tends to be a tougher issue to solve, a tougher problem to solve. So no, that's okay. If you haven't done your plumbing yet, go ahead and do this even. Don't even think about doing it exhaustively for the building. Go ahead and choose, three buildings essentially. Do it in one of them or something like that. And then, just get the basic sanitary and the hot and cold. It'd be nice to do a gray water system, but don't worry about modeling that up front. That could be the next step or something like that. We're just kind of get the basic system together. Actually, one of the challenges we had when we were working with Jacqueline's system, just so you're all aware of each other's buildings, is it's when you have things that you need to have a sanitary line dropping down through several levels, but they don't align with each other. It's very, very easy when things like one restroom is right on top of the other because the line's gonna go straight on down just in that one location. Sometimes we have to sort of carry across a certain horizontal distance and drop down in funny locations, in locations that, you know, aren't always like perfectly aligned with each other top to bottom, stuff like that. But that's okay. You just always run into the limitation on, since the pipe is sloping a little bit, you know, how many feet you can move laterally before you have a big height difference in terms of dropping on down. So for everyone who stacked things on top of each other, life's a little bit easier. If it's not, yeah, stacked up, then it's a little more work, but it's certainly solvable. And the good news about even bringing pipes on down is that if I go through and I need to bring a pipe down, if it's a 4-inch pipe or something like that, and it's up against a wall, I really need a very small little box out to kind of cover that and conceal that. As opposed to the ductwork, it's much, much bigger. So it's okay. If you even go around this building, you'll find a lot of pipes coming down. Wherever you see funny little bumps in walls that you sort of wonder what's happening there, there's either a piece of structure that's back there that's sort of poking out, there's a piece of piping that's back there that's sort of poking out, but we do that a lot. Yeah, so yeah, don't worry about doing that. That's actually kind of architecturally okay. There's ways of working around that. Okay. Then let us finish up by talking just a little bit about electrical systems, just so you have that in your field of view as you're thinking about these projects. Now, for the electrical systems, I would say that for you guys, I wouldn't necessarily think that you have to model these. I just want to sort of make you aware of how they work. But again, if you're being very complete and thorough, you could think about doing this in a portion of the building. But again, don't do it for the whole building, because you can easily spend a couple weeks just on electrical systems. But let's talk just real briefly about how electrical systems work. And to do that, let's go back over to, if you want to download it, there's a model out there, 19A. Now, with most models, it's also true with electrical that if you're going to do an awful lot of electrical work, it probably makes sense to go through and start with an electrical template. There's lots more things loaded in there that you can work with. You can copy monitor things in. Okay, in this case, what have I done? It looks like I've started with an electrical template, or at least I'm seeing some floor plans that have lighting and power associated with them, so I believe that's coming from the electrical template. Although it looks like in this model, I basically just put together a very basic building right now. So let me even kind of take a look at this. If I was going to go through and look at this as a coordination view, I don't think these are linked in. I think these are actually in the model themselves. Yep, they're just actually here. I got a ceiling, I have the walls. But let me go through and I'll put that back to electrical. Okay. So here's the way electrical basically works. Again, think about things in terms of being different terminals that are located in different places and ultimately being routed back together. So if you think about electrical, probably one of the biggest sources or one of the biggest uses that we actually get into in electrical systems, well, they tend to fall into sort of two classic categories. We have power systems, that's all those different like plugs that are around and providing either sort of plug loads or providing specific equipment. And we have both 110 volt and 220 volt. And then we also have lighting fixtures, and lighting fixtures often have switches associated with them, so you can turn them on and off. So if we're gonna model some of those things, there are actually Revit parts to do all these. Let's go out and let's look at, for example, the power floor plan and take a look. So on the wall, you will actually see little receptacle objects right there, a little duplex receptacle. That's like one of these little like two outlets on each of them. Okay, you'll notice that it is a certain elevation off the floor. It's 1'6". It has a symbol which looks appropriate for doing electrical outlets. Let me go ahead and zoom on in there. So that's our standard symbol for an electrical outlet. Okay. Let's go ahead and add some other ones. How you do that is you go to systems. You go to the electrical section of it, and I think it's going to be considered, oh, I'm trying to remember if it's a device. I think it's a device. An electrical fixture. Let's see what I got in my list now. I got thermostats, I got switches, I got a duplex receptacle. There are two types of duplex receptacles listed here. There's a standard one, which is the one you see most often, kind of hanging around in here. You also have one called a GFCI, that's a ground fault circuit interrupt. That's one of the ones we tend to put in wet locations. So if you're ever in a kitchen or in a bathroom and you're near a sink and there's a wet location, these are set up so that if ever there's a short, often because you're standing in water or water somehow has hit it and it's creating a short circuit condition, it'll flip off. It has a little circuit interrupt right there for safety. So in most dry locations, we use standard. GFCI locations, we actually have one of them that has a circuit interrupter, so if it detects a short circuit, too much power going through it, an unusual condition, it'll cut itself off for safety. You can choose whichever one you want. So I'm going to choose standard. Notice it has an elevation to it. Let me zoom on out here. I can choose whether I want to place it on a vertical face, place it on a face, or place it on a work plane. For most cases, when we're doing these type of fixtures, it makes sense to place them on a wall, so it's a vertical face. So I'll say, let's go ahead and put this on this vertical face. Let's go ahead and put that on that vertical face. And there are actually rules for how often you have to place these together. Residentially, the rule used to be that you had to go through and be able to reach that, okay, by some fixture that has a 6-foot plug. Okay? So that meant that you essentially put these at least, or the furthest apart, you put them around every 12 feet. Okay? You can put them together more closely than that because as a convenience, you want to make it available to people to have power to plug in. And especially these days when we have all our devices, I'm not sure if you've been hanging out in an airport like Concourse lately, the plugs are really very, very valuable and people fight over the plugs because you're all trying to power up your equipment. So even in this room, I think you've noticed there's all these different receptacles which are in the floor and you want to be near one of those if you're worried about your battery life. And if you aren't near one of those, you string a cord out and we all trip over it and it's a safety hazard. There's all these things that are like a, you know, part of the whole system. So you tend to like to have a lot of these things. Okay, each of them is actually rated. It has a certain load associated with it. Okay, it looks like it's 120 volts. Okay, and those are kind of standard receptacles. Now you may be wondering, do they show up in 3D also? And they do. So if I look back at this corner of the building, you can sort of see them. They're kind of like fat line right now. There they are. So that's a little duplex receptacle. It doesn't actually show the little plates, you know, where you actually have the prongs that you can plug things into. But if I want to go through and place them in this view also, I can. I can say device, receptacle, let me place it on. What's interesting, it's placing it on a face. It's placing it on the wrong face. That's interesting. I'd be better off to go through and place this in the floor plan view so I can do it on the vertical face. What this is going to do is actually just place it on the floor or place it on a work plane, kind of place it some other place. Okay, if I want to change one to be a GFCI terminal, not to worry, I can do that. Okay, now it's a GFCI one. It doesn't look any different in 3D, but it sort of has a different designation to it. Okay, so I put these guys in there and I basically indicate my plug load locations. Okay, all these different systems actually tally up to a system. We can go through and make them a system. So let me go back to the floor plan. There's my little GFCI one right down there in the corner. you could think about all these things being related to a system. What we typically do is we take a whole series of different power receptacles and we bring them on back to, as a system, to a power panel of some type. What you could do is if you choose one of them, you can say create a power system. That's somewhat similar to what we did with sprinklers. If you chose a sprinkler, you could say create a fire protection system. So I can now say I want to include that in the system. I want to include see if I can get this one too. Put it in here. Add to the circuit. I want to get you. I want to get you. And I want to get you. Okay, so now these are all considered to be part of a system. Now, you might be wondering about like these little dashed lines that are sort of floating around. And if you want to actually show the wiring between them, at least a symbolic representation of the wiring between them, you can click on this little widget and it'll actually place wires between them. Now, very often we don't draw that in the drawing. We actually just sort of leave that for the electrician to figure out what's going on. In most cases, like for a simple little schoolroom or something like that, we wouldn't actually worry about mapping out precisely where the conduits are and every last piece of the connection of exactly where the wiring is going to be. In buildings that aren't considered complex, okay, you leave it up to really the craftsman at the tail end to figure out exactly where it's going to be based on what they find in the field. In more complex buildings like a hospital or some very kind of high precision lab, you might actually go through and run conduits and really be quite precise about where everything's gonna be. Like, if you go to visit the Stanford Hospital over there, they'll tell you that, you know, they've really planned it all down to the quarter inch. Everything is known exactly where it's going to be, so there's very little tolerance for any sort of change. Looks like there's two different widgets here. A chamfered type of wiring, or an arc type of wiring. I'll do arc wiring. Okay, and that's basically indicating those are all together. And again, it's symbolic. They're not really kind of physically connected. It's really more just symbolic to indicate to someone who's looking at this that these wires are all going to get connected together into a single system. Now, you may be wondering about these things as a system, because as you go through and you hang out and kind of grab that one, okay, it seems like somehow we've connected to a system. That's all a system. If you actually want to see a little about that system and really what's included in it and really what the loads are that are coming all together, what you can do is bring up the system browser. So the system browser, you might remember, shows you all the different systems, whether it's electrical, plumbing, or mechanical, depending upon what model you're looking at. But right now you'll see I have four systems in here. I have a couple different power systems in there that have some pendant lights on them, as well as one that has a bunch of duplex receptacles on it. So you'll see as I highlight the system, it highlights it in there. It looks like I basically joined those last few duplex receptacles to a system that actually has quite a bit more. You can see I have all these different loads. So I have loads from all those. So all together, this system right now has a total load of 1,260. Okay. So when I bring that together back to the panel and I put a breaker behind it, I have to make sure that breaker can handle that kind of load. Or I'll break this into several different systems so that any individual system is not overloading its breaker. Okay, so it's kind of like most of these other things. It's all terminals, they have loads, the loads aggregate up through the wiring or piping, whatever it is, into systems, and then we go through and compare, you know, really is there something serving that system that's able to take care of its loads. So wiring is actually not too awfully bad. There's some other sort of fixtures. That's Shift F9 actually brings that thing up and down, or F9. Actually, let me close it. F9 opens it. I know that. Okay. So you can go through and do those things. If you need a 220 volt outlet, you can do something like that too. I just did a lot of residential work. I need 220 volt outlets for things like dryers and ovens and things where you need a very high kind of load. People who are in my other parts of the world are laughing at me because they use 220 all the time. Okay, which is disturbing to people from the US because we don't pay as much attention to power, but 220 you should pay attention to because it'll bite you if you're not careful. Okay, but if you need a 220 volt outlet, not to worry. We'll just go ahead and again, go out there and say systems. Go to devices. It looks like in this list, I don't really have one loaded like that. So maybe I'll try loading and see if I can find one. Oh, let me go to electrical. I'll go to the MEP version, electrical power. I think of it as a terminal. There's a duplex receptacle. Receptacle 220 volts. There it is. I'll bring that in. Pop it in right here. Now the 220, just so you recognize it graphically, looks a little bit different. It actually has three little lines to it as opposed to two little lines to it. As we go through and connect it together, it wouldn't make sense to put it on the same system because you have a 120 volt system, you have a 220 volt system, it'll be separate. Okay, so typically they go to their own breakers where it's running at the higher voltage. Okay, so 220 volts, they're kind of A-OK too. They have some other receptacles in here too. Oh, sometimes you need to put them on the floor, like this building has a lot of receptacles down on the floor, and that's okay too. Even for that, let me try that. I wonder if we can do it with just the duplex receptacle, if they have a separate one. I'm trying to remember. Let me do the insert and see if we can find a ground receptacle. Electrical. Receptacle, clean countertop receptacle. That'll be one that's at least sitting on a horizontal surface. Isolated ground. Weatherproof. Weatherproof is important in wet locations like garages, things like that, or outside. GFCI is actually what you need for a garage. Typically, it can be, weatherproof would be a bigger bonus. Depends if you're going to hose down the space or not. Weatherproof for outside. Simplex. Quadrex. Quadrex, if you've ever gone up and you've seen basically four plugs, like actually the one that's right behind me right here, this is a quad receptacle. It actually has one, two, three, four different outlets on it. Okay, so just two side by side. Emergency switches. Let me try, let me see what the countertop receptacle is doing. I think it's just gonna be a horizontally mounted one. Let me try just placing it on a face. Yep. Oh, it's interesting. It says CTR, which is going to indicate that it's at the countertop. That's not exactly what I want. Let me try a duplex receptacle. And I'll try just putting it on a face as opposed to that. Okay, and now it's down on the floor. Again, we should come up with one that's sort of a good model just specifically for being on the floor. But again, we can sort of like tie them all in. Now, you don't always put these at 12 inches off the floor if you are actually behind a counter. So if you have a 3 foot countertop, you probably want to put it closer to 3 foot 6 inches or something like that so that it's above the countertop in the backsplash. So you'll just make that 3 foot six. It's a little bit higher there. Okay, so the good news about doing this is now if you do coordination and we do flash detection, you can actually see if these things are interfering with other things, whether they're interfering with an architectural feature, or just even as you start to see these, when I do cabinet elevations, I like to see where the outlets are because sometimes you need to adjust them a little bit to allow for pieces of trim or just to kind of, put them in the right place architecturally so they line up nicely. Okay, Let's go ahead then. That's the power side of things. Look at lighting. Lighting is actually sort of pretty straightforward here. And in lighting, it's sort of a very slight variation of what we did with the daylighting analysis so far. Lighting, a lot of us sort of tackled for the first time when we were doing renderings, because especially if you're doing indoor renderings or nighttime renderings, you wanted to go ahead and put some lighting in there to kind of cast a little bit of artificial light to complement the daylighting. So we do the same thing here. So in terms of lighting, let's think about this. I could go through and put lighting in floor fixtures, or I can put them in table lamps, things like that. But if I want to do ceiling fixtures, we'll sort of mount them to a ceiling. Okay. With lighting fixtures, you're going to find that lighting fixtures, there's two versions of them. Maybe I'll do that as a starting point. See, my space here has a little bit of a ceiling to it. Okay, so what I'm going to do is basically insert some lighting fixtures. You're going to find there's, again, two versions. There's an architectural version and an MEP version. The architectural version has the lighting profile, so that'll cast accurate shadows, accurate levels of just how many lumens it's casting a certain distance away. It has what's called an IES file. And Gustavo, what's IES stand for? Because I know you were doing this in the other class. Do you remember? It's international, I don't know, there's a model. But basically,
Illuminating Engineering Society.
The Illuminating Engineering Society, which standardized this. So we have a way of comparing and figuring out if I put in two different fixtures of different types, how much light they're really throwing. So they model these and sort of figure out just what the cloud of light is that's around the different fixtures. If you go to the architectural fixtures, okay, these all have IES files. If you go to the MEP fixtures, these also have IES files, but they also have power connections, where the architectural light ones don't. So you can copy them if you need to. You've already put them in the architectural side, but you tend to want to get these that have just the actual lighting information. Let me go ahead and put one of these in. So I've downloaded a pendant light. What is this like? Actually, we don't have them in here. These are more like the ones that are downstairs in 184, where I'll say, let me go to systems. I'm gonna do a lighting fixture. I'm gonna say, place it on a face or place it on a work plane. I'm actually gonna place it on a face. I'm just gonna hang it right off the ceiling over here. That's my down light. I don't want that one. I want my pendant light, a 48-inch one, 120 volt. I'll put that right here. Let me try my 96-inch one, 120 volt. So, two bays wide. Okay, I could go ahead and put two 20-volt ones in there. It's just, you know, it still has the same lighting profile, it's just sort of fed by a different lighting system. Okay, so I can go through and put these lighting fixtures in. I'll place it on the face again. Okay, and trying to come up with a nice layout that's pretty regular. Okay, they have other types of lighting fixtures available too, though. Some of the other ones, actually, let's take a look at a single one in terms of what actually comes in. It basically just has a power connection to it. So you're basically going to run a piece of wire to it. Okay, and you know, whether that's two or three wire, whatever's necessary, it's all just sort of encapsulated in a single wire connection to it. Okay. In terms of some of the other fixtures you might want to know about, a plain recessed lighting fixture, that could be more like one of the ones where it's what I'll call a troffer. It goes up into the ceiling and kind of just has a flat surface that sort of brings the light out. Let me say 1x4. I will go through and see what's going on. I don't want to modify the lighting fixture. Oh, I'm changing that one. Hang on. Because I still have that one selected. Try that again. Lighting fixture. I'll go through and change it to my troffer. I'm going to place it on a face. Okay, so you can think about putting those in. The third kind of lighting fixture we often sort of go and put in is a recessed can light. A can light is one of these guys. A little, they're recessed up into the ceiling, they cut a hole, and they have the lighting fixture up within there. So within that, you come back and say, hey, let's go ahead and put a recessed can in. They have different sizes. These are big ones. These are like 8-inch ones. They're quite large. Okay, more appropriate for like a commercial application. So the 8-inch refers to the size of the hole. Okay. 6-inch ones are more common in residential, just a little bit smaller. Actually, these days we've gotten quite small. If we want a really clean architectural look, you might get a 4-inch or a 5-inch can, even smaller. It's very, very focused pin light as opposed to sort of a big wide light. Okay, so we go through and put these lights in here. Let's just talk about the lights and sort of what their qualities are for just a second before we actually think about how they come together. So let's start with these guys. Those guys, which are my hanging pendants, okay, let's think about how they throw light. If you think back about to the last time you were down in 184, and think about those lights that are hanging from the ceiling, how is the light actually sort of reflected in that room? How do you actually get the light? It comes from the fixture, but does it come straight to you, or does it bounce off anything? You're pointing your finger up, which is, exactly. In fact, even these lights above us right now, you'll see that these lights don't really put in down light. What they're doing is they're putting up light, and it's reflected off the ceiling. So we're depending on the ceiling to reflect that light back. So if the ceiling is bright white or some very light color, we get a lot of light back. If you put a bunch of these in and you paint the ceiling black, you actually get very little light. Okay, so it really depends on the color. But this is really what we call like indirect lighting. It kind of bounces it up, it kind of comes on down again. Overall, you would tend to call this ambient light, in that what it's doing is it's kind of generally illuminating the room, but it isn't really necessarily highlighting any specific object. It's just kind of creating an overall flow, an overall glow in the room by bouncing a lot of light off all the different surfaces. Okay, and that's kind of ambient light. On the other hand, if I look at these fixtures back over here, downlights, okay, they're very specific about what they do. So if I turn them on back where you are, or I turn them on up where I am, okay, they put light in a very specific location. Okay, right under them, it's quite bright, but as soon as you get this far away, it's not bright at all. Okay, and that's good and bad in terms of what's going on. They're great for accenting things. They're great if you want to sort of illuminate artwork on a wall. They're kind of nice that way. They're kind of very sort of focused light. They're actually not too bad for hallways and stuff like that, because in a hallway, there's nothing hanging down. So if you're moving something big way through the hallway, you're not going to bump into it and accidentally kind of knock it down. So they're pretty good in that sort of scenario. Where they aren't so good is actually sitting right over you as you're working at your computer. Okay? And if you think about how the light is thrown, you'll get a sense of why that is. So why would you not want something that's a light right over your head as you're sort of working at your computer or working at your desk? Yeah, it's just a shadow thing. It's like this weird thing happens where like it's basically illuminating the top of my shiny head, and I'm casting this big shadow kind of right over what I'm supposed to be looking at. So it's not a great light for that, because I'm going to be blocking it. Or if you put it in front of me, it might be in my eyes. So downlights aren't really necessarily very good for kind of task lighting. What we'll tend to do for more sort of very focused task lighting is we'll put individual fixtures right at your computer, pointing down at whatever the work surface is, not pointing up in your eyes, so eliminate glare, stuff like that. But downlights are pretty good for that sort of scenario. These troffers, these ones over here, okay, they're pretty good too, but what they tend to be good at is they're just giving you ambient light, but sort of pointing it down. The troffers don't really reflect much light up to the ceiling. They just kind of have light pointing down. Okay, so, you know, that's kind of the probably most economical utility sort of function. You just put some fluorescent bulbs in there. It points light down, and it's very good in sort of utility spaces. Okay, so there's different styles of lighting. But in the end, we want to do two different things. We want to understand, A, how much light is actually thrown by these things, and B, how do we actually route them all together? So let's look at both those issues. For routing them, let's look back at our ceiling plan. Let's go through and we can decide how we want to route these. For example, in this room, there's a very confusing routing scheme where Martin will have fun showing you that of the 12 different switches on the different corners of the room, it's kind of hard to figure out which ones are going to do which things. But often what we'll do is we'll route the pendant lights into a different circuit than the down lights because they really serve two different purposes. So if I wanted to, for example, create a circuit out of these lights, I could say, let's create a power circuit for them. Then I will edit the circuit and I will add in some more lights. Okay, those four lights are now part of a lighting power circuit. So I'll say finish editing that. Now if I choose and do a tab, I can show the wires. Okay, so that's a lighting power circuit for that. These are the troffers. Let's go ahead and put them on their own circuit. So I'm going to say let's create a lighting power circuit. Edit the circuit. Not too awfully bad. That's pretty good in terms of tying them all together. Now if I go to my system browser, I should have a lighting system of some type, and I should have a lighting system of some type. Let's go back and look at that. That's going to go F9. I have some different power circuits. This one has four pendant lights. That one has some duplex receptacles. That has some down lights. That's the troffers. Where are those? Those are the recessed cans. I have two different recessed cans, or plain recessed lighting fixtures. I see. Those are the troffers down at the bottom, then the cans, then those are the pendant lights over there. So I got some different systems set up right now. Again, the reason I set up the systems is I want us to be able to see what the total power load is for each of those different systems. So this one has 256 for those four. For the pendant lights, also 256. For the down lights, 400 of those. Looks like they're a little bit bigger in terms of what's going on. Okay, I can also go through and attach switches to those. So let me see if I can do this. Switches, it turns out, are just another device. They're very much like receptacles or something like that. If you say device, and oh, I have to find where this is. I'm going to think it's under electrical fixtures. There I have some switches. What do I have here? I have thermostats. I have a fan switch, a motorized switch. That's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for motorized. Those are switches, but they're not kind of switches. I want a lighting switch. So let me go through and see if I can find something that looks like that instead. Under a lighting fixture. Those are the actual lights. I always have to find these things because I don't do this stuff every day. Anyway, it's under, is it under electrical equipment? No. That's just like the panels. There's an Ethernet switch. There's the panel boards. Well, let's load them in and see where they exist. load family, electrical. I think of them as being terminals, but maybe not. Disconnect switches, duplex receptacle, lighting switches. There they are. Okay, it's in here somewhere. You must choose the family electrical. Where are they located then? Systems? It's not electrical equipment. It's not a device. Oh, lighting there. How about there? There we go. Okay, just different category. Now notice there's a couple of different sort of switches that we have loaded in this project. We have not only the switches that you manually go up and throw, but we also have things like passive infrared or dual technology occupancy sensors or daylighting sensors. Those are good switches too. They're low voltage switches, but if we want to go through and in individual rooms control the lighting based on occupancy or turn it off based on there's adequate daylighting that we don't need the artificial lighting on there, we can put in some of these. Let's go through. We have switches. There are timer switches, dimmer switches, door switches. There's single pole switches, then there's three-way and four-way. I'll tell you what the difference is. Single pole is when you go on up and you're gonna flip it, it has on or off, that's a single pole switch. Okay, a three-way switch is, it's kind of weird, the numbering always sort of throws me away, it's this way. Three-way is that I have a switch over on this side, I have a switch by that door. Either one of those switches I could turn on and it will turn on or turn off the lights. So there's two switches, but they're called three-way switches. Okay? If I want to have three light switches, that's a four-way switch. Okay, I'm not sure where the four, yeah, Brittany's giving me that look like, huh? Okay, so let's put a single pole switch on this one. Okay, for this other one over here, let's go ahead and we'll do sort of like a little three-way switch. So I'll put one over on this wall. And maybe I'll put one over on this wall. Generally, three-way switches are used, like in applications where you're coming in from an exterior door, you're moving through the room, and you're moving into a hallway. So you don't want to go back and hit it. Where if you're just going into a room and there's one door in and out, you tend to have a single pole switch. Okay, so I got my switches. Let's see what I can do here. I'm gonna go through and grab my power circuit. Oops, I have to grab the circuit, which is there. I'm gonna edit the circuit. I'm gonna add to it and see if I can get that switch in there. There it is. Okay, now that switch is considered to be part of the circuit. Okay, so it'll all be tallied together. There's actually a switch system too. Let's see if I can make this work. Select the switch that goes to that system. It's right there. Okay, that's considered a switching system. So let me go back to my system browser. Let me do it on this side over here. So I will go through and grab that same series of lights. That's a system. Not that. Let me come back and grab that light. Also make a switch system. So all these things are going to be switched together. Then I'm going to select the switches as being that one. Can I get that one too? I'm going to mess that up somehow. Four fixtures. Okay. I think that is right. Let's come back and do F9. That's a thermostat. That's my wall occupancy center. Where are my switch systems? There's a lighting switch. There's just more unplanned power right now. Okay, ultimately we gotta get all assigned to something. But enough of that. That's how you basically get them in there to start with. Let's talk about how you actually figure out how much daylighting is actually being cast. So this is something we actually did in conjunction with Eric's class. And Gustavo worked on this very, very hard in terms of figuring how to do this. Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to basically use something which is very much like doing daylighting analysis, the same plugin, but actually reset it a little bit so that it not only considers daylighting, but it actually considers artificial lighting too. So a little bit of both. Okay, and here's how it basically works. Okay, for this project, if I want to go through and use daylighting analysis on it, what I want to do is actually use the little daylighting plugin. Actually, let's see if it'll actually work in this problem. It's kind of interesting because I think it will, but let us see. I'm going to go through and even in here. Oh, no, it's actually, this is one model. I guess that should work. Let me come back in and in my floor plan view. That's not good looking. Let me just make sure there's a floor on this and make sure there's a room in here because the room actually needs to happen too. Okay, and like a lot of things, this room has to extend up so it actually hits the ceiling, so it actually is considered to be an enclosed space like that. Okay, super. I've got a floor, I've got a room. Those are the two things I needed for daylighting. What I'm gonna do is go over to the analysis tab and say that I'm gonna run a daylighting analysis. I'm gonna start just by running a daylighting analysis because, you know, that's a good starting point, but it's gonna generate some different views for me. Say super, yada, yada, yada. I'll just make it low resolution. Okay, the big thing we need to do is basically go through and tell the model that we need to go through and consider those lights. So there's two ways we can go through and do that. If you go through and just create a power or a 3D view like a camera, for example, if I go through and put a camera in the space, okay, and you see all those different lighting fixtures in there. If I go through and do a cloud analysis right now and do something called an illuminance rendering, okay, it'll go through and for all these different surfaces plot out what the color temperature is. It'll figure out just really, you know, how much illuminance is hitting each of those different surfaces. And the way we typically do that is under the View tab, we say we're going to render in the cloud. Let it do its thing. Now, as we're rendering in the cloud, this is going to be very sensitive to your colors, your materials, your shininess, all that stuff sort of kicks in. Something's working hard. Not sure what it's doing. As it's doing that, let me just go out to 360 rendering and see if I can like bring up an example for you where we did it. That's not good. The server refused the connection.
That's funny.
I feel very, I wonder if I should take that personally. I'm wondering if somehow the server's sort of complaining, or is like sort of bottoming out. I'm sort of suspecting it is, because if we can't get it over on this side, and it's not happening over in the remit side, I think maybe the server's having some issue. Oh, that's funny. It's waiting on both sides. Still waiting. Okay. Not to worry. What's going to happen if it ever does come back is in the kind of cloud-based system, you know, we'll see these color maps that kind of indicate how much illumination is on each of the different surfaces. Back over here in this side of the equation, what's going to happen is a new 3D view is actually going to show up. A 3D view is called like a 3D lighting analysis model. Let me see if it actually exists in here. Here's one. There it is. Lighting analysis view. Well, okay, I'll accept that it failed. That's not going to stop us from showing you how it works. So there's this lighting analysis 3D model. Here's what you got to do. Whatever settings you have set for rendering on this will be the ones that get carried forward into the lighting analysis. So in this view, if we would, for example, like to consider a certain time of day, a certain day of the year, as well as turning on artificial lights, what we'll do is go to this view, okay, and then for its rendering settings, we'll say, let's talk about how we want to consider this. Do we want it to be interior only considering the sun? That would be the way we would typically do it if we're doing for daylighting analysis. We'd do interior, but we'd only consider the sunlighting that's coming into the windows. If you want to also consider the artificial lighting, we'll say sun and artificial. That'll be a hybrid. That'll include both the sunlight as well as the light from the artificials. It'll also, if you switch it to artificial only, give you a lighting analysis which is only the artificial lights. So just the lighting levels associated with all that. And for the artificial lights, you have the choice of, for each of them, you can turn them on or off, you can put them into groups, you can associate a dimming level anywhere from 0 to 1, 0 being completely dim, 1 being fully on. So you can basically control the lights. So if you set the settings here, okay, say okay to that, and then come back over to the lighting analysis, what you do is here is we're going to switch it up just a little bit, because we're going to start with that analysis, but we're going to change it a little bit by hitting this little guy that looks like a gear over there to customize its settings. What we're going to do is, typically what happens in here, rendering settings for the light analysis model view, there's this whole notion of whether you're going to override the analysis with a lighting scheme. And in this case, oh, I always have to think about this in terms of which way the direction is. Rendering settings for the light, I think what we're going to do is turn that on, because what we want to do is we want to take the default analysis settings and we want to override them by putting in the lighting scheme, which included the artificial lights. Actually, Gustavo, does that sound right? I'm trying to think of, I'm always confused on the directionality of that checkbox.
You don't click it.
You don't click it. Because what we're going to do then, okay, so is it that the lighting scheme, if we wanted to use the lighting scheme, okay, then we'd turn that off as override here. Okay, so that's exactly the opposite of what I said at first. Okay, so if we don't override the lighting scheme, then we're going to use lighting scheme settings from the view as opposed to overriding them with the settings in here. Okay, that's what it is. So leave that thing turned off. I think that'll pretty much be it in terms of what you want to have happen here. But we'll say, let's go ahead and save that. and now we can start that analysis. So the big key thing we have to do is, you know, not so much, what is it? I guess that I wanted to see the best way to express this. It's really just go through and make sure that you are using the lighting analysis settings view, okay, and like adjusting the rendering settings that are associated with that. So again, the thing is, it's working. Lighting analysis model view, choose that view, and then for the 3D view, look for rendering settings. Okay, and change this to be set in artificial only. It's like I didn't save it. Okay, and then when you go through and run the lighting analysis, it'll include those. Okay, let me see if anything did come back on the other side in terms of view. Render gallery. Still waiting for it. Interesting. Looks like somehow the server is still just having some troubles. But when it comes back, what it's gonna do is give us like basically that 3D view with colors mapped all over it, as well as the ability to then go through and kind of choose the daylighting values. I'm trying to think, if you go back to, oh, it was about session 8 or something like that, when we were talking about daylighting, I think when we were doing it for Gustavo's class too, I think I showed that in this class too, where you could turn on the values as well as just the color maps. So you could actually sort of see the precise values. Okay, so that, if the servers are not going to cooperate, is about all we wanted to show you in terms of daylighting. So the big thing with electrical stuff is basically put the terminals in place, get them routed together, and then you start to have an electrical system, at which point an electrical engineer, kind of in the same sense with all these systems, we've always worried about the terminals and getting them back to a central location, a mechanical room or an electrical room. Yeah, but at that point, an engineer who specializes in that discipline would take a look at all those different loads coming to the panel and start to put the high power system in to distribute the power to those panels. Or even in our case, we've been bringing all the sewage and the water down to a mechanical room somewhere in the basement. There's still some additional work to be done in terms of putting some pumps or some systems to connect to the main city sewer system in there. But yeah, that's kind of a whole nother kind of discipline in terms of doing that stuff. Beautiful. Okay. Let us see it. Any questions kind of hanging around, or you feeling good about Thursday and what you're going to do for Thursday? No? Still got to think about it a little bit. Again, don't feel like, actually, if you want to sort of see what people have done in the past, you can actually see a lot of presentations that are out there. If you go out to YouTube, actually, I'll even put some of the examples of the sets out there. If I go to B from last quarter, you'll actually find there, here are the final presentations from last time. And there's all sorts of stuff kind of hanging out in there with people talking about their buildings and their floor plans and stuff like that. And I would encourage you to sort of only look at this briefly, because I want you, if you're looking at it, I want you to think about it in terms of ideas of what you can use, okay, but don't necessarily feel that you have to go through and create the incredible slide sets that you're seeing, you know, like in these presentations. People put a lot of work into coming up with sort of a very formal presentation, you know, with good renderings, a lot of different things like that, to kind of really sort of illustrate the idea of their different projects. I think you guys have been working more on sort of the mechanical parts, you know, the actual systems. Like for example, a view like this is a good one. Yeah, as a really high level overview of just explaining about your mechanical system, like a 3D view that really kind of has the color-coded supplies and returns. That's a great view for just really explaining at a high level what's going on in your whole system. Yeah, you don't need to go into much more detail than that in terms of at a high level, just sort of explaining what's going on with your systems. I think if I came back on the same one. So here's a floor plan, the structural floor plan, some notion of what the main beam sizes were, what they started out being, what they ended up being. It's fairly straightforward in terms of the way people present it. But again, for all this, here's like the someone's analytical model. Well, that's actually Dominique's, so I can spot it. Okay, just in her case, we're looking at that cantilever over there and looking at the sizing of what was happening in there. So at a high level, just kind of think about the best way to go through and present the big ideas. Don't worry about it being four-ring extravaganza with circus clowns and balloons and all the things that we often put into presentations. I'd rather have you spend the time just kind of really thinking about the systems and what you want to say about how you change the systems, as opposed to putting a lot of time into kind of working on the presentation side. Does that sort of make sense? Okay, more or less. I know for some of you, you got a lot of stuff to show, so it's almost more thinking about how you can best use that time. Really what's going to happen is if everyone shows up, we got Henry, Christine, like six people, I don't know, it's like 15 to 20 minutes. I don't want to say there's any more than that, because then you'll be tempted to try and really do something quite detailed. So I'd almost say, I'm going to give you the exact opposite advice most people would say. Plan on 15 minutes, and it'll probably expand to 20 minutes, as opposed to people say, oh, make 30 minutes of slides and then try and squeeze them into 15. Yeah, just because I think it'd be more interesting to have a discussion about your designs than just worry about just having it all presented. Okay. So, any last questions? No? Just thinking about the week ahead. Okay, no worries. Let us adjourn for today, then. And on Thursday, come on back and just wow us with a few features of your project. Again, don't worry, it won't be 100% complete, and it's not expected to be at that point. Just think about a couple things about it you want to share with us and really focus on those.